The earth is the Lord's and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. For he founded it upon the seas and established it upon the waters. Who may ascend the hill of the Lord? Who may stand in his holy place? He who has clean hearts, hands, and a pure heart, who does not lift up his soul to an idol or swear by what is false. He will receive blessing from the Lord and vindication from God his Saviour. Such is the generation of those who seek him, who seek your face, O God of Jacob. Lift up your heads, O you gates. Be lifted up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord, strong and mighty, the Lord, mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, O you gates. Lift them up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is he, this King of glory? The Lord Almighty, he is the King of glory. Well, good morning and welcome to Quorn Baptist Church. May God's blessing be upon you, whether you're here in person or watching on YouTube or listening to the service on CD. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, you are Almighty God. You are the King of glory. You are awesome and holy. You spoke this universe into existence with just a word. All creation demonstrates your wisdom and power, and yet you have set your love upon us. All else that is worshipped as a god is false and will let people down, but you are faithful and you are true. We come into your presence, conscious of our unworthiness and our failure to live up to all that you intend for us to be. Forgive our sins and draw us close to yourself so that we might have joy in worshipping you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. You know that when we come here, it is to meet with God. And over the last 3 weeks, I've given you opportunity to quieten down your hearts before you actually come into God's presence. And in that time, to cast your cares upon him, to confess your sins to him, to get right with him, to get ready to quieten your heart to worship him. This week, I didn't specially set out for you to do that. And it was a test, really, to see whether that was in your heart, whether you'd gained anything from those 3 weeks of opportunity, whether you'd gained that the benefit of actually coming before God in that way. Well, we don't want to do things as rules in this church. That's not how God works, is it? He's not a legalistic God. He's a loving Heavenly Father. But he does want us to do things from our heart and to learn when we learn something from him, not necessarily from me, but from him, that we go along with that, that we take it into our hearts and we live it out. Of course, we can't always have organized times of silence. It won't work for all age services or at cafe style services. But as individuals, you can bring yourselves before God. Well, I'd like you to have just now an opportunity, a different sort of opportunity, an opportunity to greet one another and to say hi to those around you, to acknowledge your brothers and sisters in Christ, and to acknowledge that we're worshiping him together. We're here together, not as a, what you wouldn't call us a team, would you? We're the body of Christ, but we're working together. So let's share the grace. We'll just say hi to one another. If you are able, if you are able, if you are able now that you've sat down to, if you are able to stand, let's sing praise to our wonderful God and Saviour. But just to warn you, we've got two songs. So don't sit down straight after the first. Otherwise, you'll be stood up again. But you can do that if you want to. If you want that exercise, feel free. Okay. So let's stand and sing then, if you can.
Thanks to the Lord, our God and King, His love endures forever. For He is good, He is above all things, His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise. With a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, His love endures forever. For the life that's been reborn, His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Forever God is faithful, forever God is strong. Forever God is with us, forever. Forever God.
Well, Mandy, we look forward to all that you have for us.
It's going to be brilliant.
I know, well, it's coming, promise. I'm just planning it in my head as I'm sorting this out now. Am I in the right place, Tim? Thank you. Okay, so we're going to start with a bit of a game. I don't know whether you know this game. And the game is rock, paper, scissors. Do you know it? Right, okay. If you don't know it, okay, we put our hands behind our backs and go one, two, three. And then you come out with either a rock, paper, or scissors, okay? And you're all playing against me. So basically, if you've got scissors and I've got paper, then you beat me. Okay, if I've got a rock and you've got scissors, I beat you because I can blunt the scissors. And whatever the other one is, I'm struggling now. If you've got paper and I've got a rock, then the paper covers the rock, doesn't it? Okay, then I know this game, I think. Okay, right. Okay, so we'll have a bit of a practice round. Okay, for a start. So hands behind your back or whatever. One, two, three. Oh, so if you've got scissors, okay, then I blunt scissors. If you've got a rock, we're okay. If you've got paper, then you beat me. Did you get paper? Oh, Colin's got his competitive head on. Okay, then. Did you? Okay, okay. Okay, one more practice, just one more practice. One, two, three. Okay, so, yeah. So if you're a rock, you beat my scissors. Okay, so we're going to have a few rounds of this now for real. How many? So basically, if you, if I beat you, if my hand symbol beats yours, okay, then you're out for the rest of the game. Okay. How many people do you think will be left in the game after a few rounds? How many do you think, Reuben? Just two, yeah? How many do you think will be left in? Four or five after a few rounds, okay. It probably won't be everybody, will it? But it probably won't be that there is nobody left in, I think. We're sort of a bit either way, are we? We're unsure, aren't we, really? So let's have a few rounds then. One, two, three. Okay, so if you are a rock, you are out. Oh, Max. Okay, so that's a few out already. One, two, three. Okay, again, if you're a rock, you're out, I'm afraid, Matt. The rocks are out. One, two, three. Okay, if you're a pair of scissors, you're now out. One, two, three. If you are a piece of paper, you're now out. Let's just have one more. One, two, three. Okay, if you are if you are a pair of scissors, who's still left in? There we go, a few. So your guess, it was about four or five? I think you might be about right there. Okay, so well done, everybody. Okay, four or five left in, not everybody, but not everybody out. We didn't know really what the answer would be, did we? Okay, so think about it now. If I said to you on three, I'm always going to bring out a piece of paper. Okay, I'm always going to bring out a piece of paper. All right, and let's. So let's play the game again. Reuben, I was looking at Ethan, but same Reuben. Reuben and Ethan, have a think about it together. If I'm always going to bring out a piece of paper, how many people are going to be left in the game after a few rounds? What do you think? Everybody, aren't they? Let's have a go then, shall we? One, two, three.
What are you doing, Colin?
Oh, he's part of the illustration. Don't worry about it. One, two, three.
One, two, three. One, two, three. Okay, so how many were out? Let's do it that way. How many were out that time? Oh, wait, why was that, Colin?
I thought you were going to tell me. We weren't going to tell the truth.
Oh, and why was that, Barbara? Oh,
it's good news.
Okay. Okay. This morning, we're thinking about a big, big word that's in the Bible, and that word is assurance. Assurance. Now, assurance means to be absolutely certain of something. It means I know, I really, really know. And this morning, we're talking about I really, really know that because I love Jesus, I am going to live with Jesus forever in heaven. I really, really know it. Okay? Because I love Jesus, I really, really know it. And just like my response was always the same, if you love Jesus, you can really, really know that when you get to heaven, he will say, come on in. His response will always be the same. Come on in. And that's what assurance is all about. You can be so very certain that because you love Jesus, you will live with him in heaven forever. Not only that, the assurance also means that when you want to go and tell other people about your friend Jesus, you can be absolutely certain, I know, I really, really know, that you are telling the truth about him. Now, the person you're telling about Jesus might not know it's the truth. They might say, how do you know that? But assurance is knowing, really, really knowing that you are telling the truth when you tell other people about your friend Jesus. Not only that, it's also knowing, really, really knowing that those who we love and those who we love, who love Jesus and who have died, who we no longer see, we can really, really know that we will be with them again someday in heaven. Isn't that amazingly good news? Yeah. Let's pray and say thank you, Jesus, for all that you did. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you once again for Jesus. We thank you that he was obedient to you and he died on the cross and he rose again 3 days later. And because of this, all of us, any of us who want to believe in you, who wants to be your friend, who wants to make you Lord of our lives, can have that assurance, that certainty that I know, I really, really know that we will be with you in heaven forever and forever. And I thank you that you care for those who we love, who have gone before us, who loved you. You are caring for them and we will see them again someday. And we thank you that you will be with us as we aim to tell others about you. And we know that it is the truth. We thank you for all of these things in the precious name of Jesus. Amen.
Well, you didn't let us down. That was really good. Thank you. Well, the song, My Lighthouse, is all about God's faithfulness to everyone who trusts in him. Well, if you're able, let's stand and let's sing, In My Wrestling, In My Doubts.
In my wrestling and in my doubts, in my failures, you won't walk out. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Oh, you are the peace in my troubled sea. In the silence, you won't let go. In the questions, your truth will hold. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Oh, you are the peace in my troubled sea. My lighthouse, my lighthouse, shining in the darkness, I will follow you.
Seated. Well, young folk, we've had a good time together, but Sunday Club beckons, and so we'll see you later. But for now, we're going to pray for you as you go. Father, bless all who are in Sunday Club today. Give them a fun time and help them to understand more of why Jesus came and your great love for them. Amen. Well, we're coming to a time of prayer, and to lead us into that, we've got a song that is itself a prayer. Lord, I come to you.
And Lord, I've come to know the weaknesses I see in me will be stripped away.
Lord, Father, King, Light of the world, Saviour, risen and ascended Lord, we rejoice at your resurrection and what that means for us all. We give grateful thanks that your Spirit is with us today, dwells within us, now and forever, as we come before you. I invite you to speak out or pray silently, short prayers of thanks and recognition for who our King is in our lives right now.
Thank you that you're the Lord of all creation.
Thank you for our hope in you. Father, you are the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end.
If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all of our righteousness.
Mm-hmm. Our friend and our protector through thick and thin. And now, Lord, we think about the world, and I confess to be distressed and dismayed at what goes on. Our world, the wars, the poverty, the suffering, the pain. Lord, you are such a powerful God. We know you could just intervene and change that. And Lord, this morning we ask you to intervene in the lives of powerful politicians all over the world. We think of the leaders of Russia, the leaders of China, North Korea. You could bring them to your table if you so chose. And yet you've given us free will, Lord, free will to choose. But I pray, Lord, that they would have the opportunity to discover you and change their ways. We think of others who are very powerful because of the money they have and the power that they can use to twist and turn the commodities of our world so that people suffer. We think of the criminals, Lord, who think nothing of trafficking people, of selling drugs to cause pain, distress, and death. All of those actions, Lord, by those people can make or break the lives we live too. And Lord, in the midst of this, you have a plan. And I confess, I don't always see your plan. And I doubt if any of us always see that plan. But we know and trust in you. We know your promise to bring all things together for good. We know you have a life and you know what the future holds. May we, as your obedient servants, may the actions that we take, the prayers we say, may we do what you need us to do, Lord, and all of our fellow Christians, that we together can make a difference in the lives of others here in our country and across the whole world. And Lord, we fervently pray, may your spirit rise up and move within all of these nations. And now we bring prayers before you about the situations we want to lay in front of you now. So short prayers, Lord, of things that trouble or distress you.
Media pushing morality as normal. Father, we pray that you will bring peace in Ukraine at the end to this horrible war. Father, use your power to your God.
Father, use these tragedies to bring people to face to up to their need of a saviour and that they might receive Christ. Amen.
Amen. And so, Lord, we take a moment and in our own personal prayers, we bring people, we bring situations before you that are on our hearts. People who are suffering, people who are needing God's particular guidance and support right now. Lord, in your earthly life, you bore our pain, our grief, and our suffering. You know what we go through only too well. Yet you stand with us in our situations. You comfort us in our distress. And when the going gets tough, you carry us. May we continue to feel that, to know you, to hold your hope tightly within our hearts and our life's experience. You who suffered and died, that we might have new life in you forever, and you sent us your Spirit. Your Spirit to be you in our hearts and in our lives. May we be obedient to you, Lord. May we be your servants, even in our sinfulness. So, Lord, continue to hold us in the palm of your hand. Continue to dance the dance with us as our partner, even when life throws rain and storms. But life has joy and fulfillment as well. Our God and our Creator. And so I close with the chorus of the song that we've all just sung. Hold me close, let your love surround me. Bring me near, draw me to your side. And as I wait, I'll rise up like the eagle and I will soar with you. Your Spirit leads me on in the power of your love. Amen. Amen.
On what does our hope of getting into heaven rest? Is it on ourselves? No, our only hope is in the finished work of Jesus, and that's all we need. Praise God. But we're going to sing again, and the song starts, "Before the throne of God above, I have a strong, a perfect plea," and we do. Let's stand then, if you're able, and we'll sing.
Our reading this morning is taken from 1 John chapter 2 and then chapter 4, and starting on page 1226, 1226 in the Pew Bible. So 1 John 2, verse 18. Dear children, this is the last hour. And as you have heard that the Antichrist is coming, even now many Antichrists have come. This is how we know it is the last hour. They went out from us, but they did not really belong to us. For if they had belonged to us, they would have remained with us. But their going showed that none of them belonged to us. But you have an anointing from the Holy One, and all of you know the truth. I do not write to you because you do not know the truth, but because you do know it, and because no lie comes from the truth. Who is the liar? It is the man who denies that Jesus is the Christ. Such a man is the Antichrist. He denies the Father and the Son. No one who denies the Son has the Father. Whoever acknowledges the Son has the Father also. See that what you have heard from the beginning remains in you. If it does, you also will remain in the Son and in the Father. And this is what he promised us, even eternal life. I am writing these things to you about those who are trying to lead you astray. As for you, the anointing you received from him remains in you, and you do not need anyone to teach you. But as his anointing teaches you about all things, and as that anointing is real, not counterfeit, just as it has taught you, remain in him. And now, dear children, continue in him, so that when he appears, we may be confident and unashamed before him at his coming. If you know that he is righteous, you know that everyone who does what is right has been born of him. And then chapter 4, verses 1 to 6. Dear friends, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God, because many false prophets have gone out into the world. This is how you can recognize the Spirit of God. Every spirit that acknowledges that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is from God. But every spirit that does not acknowledge Jesus is not from God. This is the spirit of the Antichrist, which you have heard is coming, and even now is already in the world. You, dear children, are from God and have overcome them, because the one who is in you is greater than the one who is in the world. They are from the world and therefore speak from the viewpoint of the world, and the world listens to them. We are from God, and whoever knows God listens to us. But whoever is not from God does not listen to us. This is how we recognize the spirit of truth and the spirit of falsehood. Amen.
Just a brief prayer. Heavenly Father, bless the words of my lips and the meditations of each of our hearts for Christ's sake. Amen. Amen. So, keep going with God. There's so many themes in this little book of 1 John. We had last week, we had the theme of love. But I didn't cover everything that John said about love in there. But it occupied a full sermon. And I appreciated preaching it. Whether you appreciated receiving it, I don't know. But this, I'm going to be looking at different verses scattered all the way through this 1 John, because I want to see what he is saying about his desire. Keep going with God. And here he reveals, let me switch this on, this will work this week. And the reason it will work this week is because I found out what was wrong last week. And it was my PowerPoint. My PowerPoint was totally screwed up because there's a little facility that I hadn't spotted in OpenOffice. And when you accidentally click on it, it puts duplicate slides in. So I was clicking and it was moving, but producing the same slide. So you didn't see any difference. So yes, this week it will work, so long as I've switched it on, which I have, right? Okay, so John reveals four reasons why God has inspired him to write this letter to God's people. And this is the first one. I do not write to you because you do not know the truth, but because you do know it, and because no lie comes from the truth. The letter is directed at those already on the journey of faith, whether they are new believers, as we thought about last week, or growing believers, or mature believers. It's for all of us. We all need this letter. We are living in the time of the spirit of Antichrist, and we can certainly see hostile action being taken against the church, even in this country. And this action has led many churches to conform to the world. For example, with regard to same-sex marriage, which I heard on the radio this morning, that the Church of Scotland have said, yeah, that's okay. We can live with that. But that's not their end game. Their end game is to silence the Bible-believing church, to make us afraid to preach the gospel or even to pray with people. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, so that you may know that you have eternal life. So what is written in this letter is to give us complete assurance that we are saved and safe in Christ. Once we believe, we gain and have eternal life. And so we have confidence to continue to trust in Jesus as the Christ, the only Savior of the world. He has done something for us that can never be undone. I'm writing these things to you who believe in the name. Oh, I've already got that. Did I press the? Yeah, there we go. Maybe I got it wrong on the slide again. Maybe I hit that button again. So let's hope this is working. He says, I'm writing these things to you about those who are trying to lead you astray. The prime reason for this letter is that there are people actively out to deceive Christians. They want to steal our confidence in God's salvation. They want to distract us from following the Christ. The church is under attack, and we need ammunition to defeat the lies of the enemy. My dear children, I write this to you so that you will not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have one who speaks to the Father in our defense, Jesus Christ, the righteous one. Dear children, keep yourselves from idols. This letter was written to help us steer clear of sin, and in particular to shun worshipping what is not God. In other words, going after idols such as money or even media personalities, believing them and the lies that they tell us. You know, if we are deflected from the gospel, we are being deflected into impotence. So what is the threat, or where is the threat? The man who says, I know him, but does not do what he commands, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. See, right in the midst of the church, there are people who will be living contrary to the truth. And on the radio today, speaking on behalf of the LGBT community, there was a man who was a minister of a church, who was himself, I think, possibly gay. Right in the middle of the church, there are people who will be living contrary to the truth of Scripture. And their lives can entice us to step outside of how we should live. Just as a serpent in the garden enticed Eve to take and eat the forbidden fruit. Well, that's one threat. Do not love the world or anything in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For everything in the world, the cravings of sinful man, the lust of his eyes, and the boasting of what he has and does, comes not from the Father, but from the world. Well, unfortunately, our own hearts can be a threat. If we allow ourselves to be enticed by the world, we will move away from God. Dear children, this is the last hour. And as you have heard that the Antichrist is coming, even now, many Antichrists have come. This is how we know it is the last hour. Satan has been cast out of heaven, and he knows that his time is short. It is his last hour. But at present, the Antichrist is being held back by God from appearing. He won't appear until quite late. So all that Satan has at his disposal are people who are willing to fight against Christ, people who, for one reason or another, hate God's people and are actively out to corrupt the church and are willing to lie in order to achieve that aim. They have no love for the truth. I must say, like Colin, I was debating which way Mandy would go. Would she go with the assurance of salvation, or would she go with the lies and deception? And I fooled you. And so, you know, there was that. But there are people like that who are out to lie, prepared to lie, happy to lie. They've got no love for the truth. Who is the liar? It is the man who denies that Jesus is the Christ. Such a man is the Antichrist. He denies the Father and the Son. Our enemies are prepared to lie and to state as though it was a fact that Jesus wasn't the Christ. He was just a man. He never came to life again. His disciples stole the body and made up all this nonsense of him being the Christ. There are people who say that. Dear children, do not let anyone lead you astray. He who does what is right is righteous, just as he, God, is righteous. He who does what is sinful is of the devil, because the devil has been sinning from the beginning. The reason the Son of God appeared was to destroy the devil's work. People will do their best to lead us astray into Satan's ways. If we don't keep with God, we may not lose our salvation, but we will certainly lose our role as salt and light. And that's what Satan wants. He wants to render Christians ineffective. He's won, hasn't he? Who makes us ineffective? if the gospel is never proclaimed. So the answer, knowing the truth, defends us. And this letter begins by reminding us that the message we have heard is eyewitness testimony. That which we have seen and heard, we declare to you. The apostles had seen the Christ. They'd heard him preach. They'd even touched him both before and after he was raised from the dead. And so we can have complete confidence in the message of salvation. We also know the truth of who we are. And this is the first thing that we have to recognize. If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves. Well, we don't claim to be without sin, do we? We're not deceiving ourselves. We know the truth. It says we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. Unfortunately, we do sin. We can't hide from that. And of course, sin is wrong and it needs forgiving. And so we should want to shun it. But of course, there is forgiveness if we confess our sins. And no matter how others try to waylay us, their sinful ways are not for us. If you read in the letters to the churches in the book of Revelation, you read of Jezebel, who was leading people astray. Into sexual sin. Their sinful ways are not for us. We want to be without sin. We need our sins forgiven. We also know this truth about who we are. How great is the love the Father has lavished on us that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. Dear friends, now we are children of God. And what we will be has not yet been made known. But we know that when he appears, we should be like him. For we shall see him as he is. It's talking about Jesus when Christ appears. So although we sin, we're now God's children, with God himself looking after us and loving us. And that's despite us still doing wrong. That song, my name is written on his heart. If only his name was written on my heart in the same way. If only his name was engraved upon my hands. But we still sin. So if we sin, it doesn't mean that we've lost our salvation. It doesn't mean that we aren't God's children. But wonderfully, there are better things to come for us when Jesus returns, because then we will be like him and all sin will be gone. Here and now, we're God's children, but we still fail. We know that we live in him and he in us because he has given us of his Spirit. We don't have to debate whether we belong to Christ. The presence of his Spirit within testifies to our spirit that we are indeed God's children. God so wants us to know that we are his children that he hasn't left it to chance. He's put his Spirit within us. You know, when I became a Christian, it was not difficult for me to pray, Father. That's because the Spirit was in me. And I knew that he is Abba, Father. But we also know what to live for. The world and its desires pass away. But the man who does the will of God lives forever. Few people today want technology that is out of date. Technology that no longer works safely or reliably. They want the most up-to-date that they can afford. And so likewise, since all that the world can offer is passing away, why hanker for it? Why not grasp hold of what will last forever and will, to use it common parlance, will future-proof your life? We know what to live for. And this is what he promised us, even eternal life. Eternal life, anyone? Who else can promise you eternal life? Only God's Son. Do not be surprised, my brothers, if the world hates you. Oh, the world hates me. I must be doing something wrong. No, not if they hate us simply for living for Jesus. Not if they hate us because we're Christians. We don't live for the world's praise or even its acceptance. We look above the world to him who will say, well done, good and faithful servant. So, what preachers can we believe? Can you believe me? Dear friends, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God. Because many false prophets have gone out into the world. This is how you can recognize the Spirit of God. Every spirit that acknowledges that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is from God. The spirits that we are to test aren't disembodied. They aren't ghosts. They are the spirits by which people styling themselves as prophets or preachers are being led. Anyone giving a prophecy or a sermon ought to be being led by the Holy Spirit of God. But we aren't to assume that to be the case. That is what this says. Don't believe every spirit. We are commanded to test every spirit by which a message is given. We do that the only way that we can, and that is to test the words they speak, whether they conform to the gospel or not. We do have other tests. For example, Jesus tells us that we shall know them by the fruit of their lives, and Paul reiterates that. However, if we've only just met someone, or if we've gone along to a conference, it's our first time for this person preaching there, then the fruit of their lives is not something that we have enough evidence to judge them by. Instead, we need this quicker test. And that test is, what are they saying about Jesus? The enemy cannot bear to honor Jesus or to speak the whole truth about him. There are plenty of false prophets going around, so we need to be on our guard. False prophets are among the ranks of professors of theology. They may be a pastor of a church, or they may just be one of those charismatic people able to influence people at a one-to-one level, drawing disciples after themselves. That's what happened in my old church in Enfield. Someone came in saying, we don't need the Bible anymore, we've got the Spirit. And several people followed him. Tragic. Satan's agents are not simply demons or the demon-possessed. They may well be wolves in sheep's clothing, appearing reasonable initially till they've hooked another victim. Someone may say something very apt or very scriptural, but we need to know that they are speaking from God. Satan himself used scripture to tempt Christ. The scripture was true, but it was being misapplied. And people speaking from God and people not speaking from God may well be attempting to lead us astray by misapplying scripture. We've got to learn to recognize the voice of God. And as soon as we can do that, we'll be able to spot the voice of the enemy. Jesus said that the sheep will follow him because they know his voice, and they will flee from a stranger because they do not know his voice. You know, the voice of God has got a particular tone when addressing his children. For example, it's never spiteful. It's never nasty. It's never mocking. But the content of what God says is key. It will always speak the truth about Jesus. For a message to be from God, the speaker must agree that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh. Anyone we listen to must conform to this test in all they say and do. Well, what does it mean to say Jesus Christ has come in the flesh? It says, actually, an awful lot. And I'll unpack that phrase for you now. Firstly, it means that Jesus, the Jesus of the Gospels, is the Christ, the one spoken of in Old Testament scriptures, who will be the Savior of the world. Secondly, Jesus has come in the flesh means that he existed before he took flesh. In other words, that he did not simply begin when he was born like we are. Also, that when he came, he was actually made man. He became fully human. He wasn't pretending to be human. Only if Christ was fully human could he die in our place and take him upon himself the punishment due to all humanity. That Jesus has come in the flesh confirms that he did obtain our salvation by his death on the cross. The Greek tense is the perfect tense, has come, but it also means has come and is still. It insists that Jesus continues to be human. It says that he has come in the flesh and still is in the flesh. The one who is fully God is now also fully human. But of course, this can only be if he is fully human right now, if he was indeed resurrected from the dead and has a glorified body able to live in heaven. A short phrase, Jesus Christ has come in the flesh. But such depth of meaning in so short a statement. God will never contradict any of this, but false prophets will. Well, we must believe Scripture. That's our authority. We accept man's testimony. When it's a court of law, we accept man's testimony. But God's testimony is greater because it is the testimony of God, which he has given about his Son. Anyone who believes in the Son of God has this testimony in his heart. Once we have trusted Jesus to save us, we have accepted God's testimony in our hearts. We have received his promises. Until you have trusted in Jesus, none of this will be real to you. But as soon as you trust Jesus, you will know that what God has promised is relevant and meaningful to you, and you have been saved. And this passage continues. And this is the testimony. God has given us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. He who has the Son has life. He who does not have the Son of God does not have life. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, so that you may know that you have eternal life. It's as simple as that. If you've opened the door of your life to Jesus, if you've asked him to forgive you, then he will come in and he will forgive and he will make you a child of God and he will put his Spirit in you and he will give you eternal life, which no one can take away. And if you trust what God says, then he wants you to know that all of this is true. He wants you to be confident that you have been saved and that you have begun to experience right now living with God in your life. And that's what eternal life is, to know God here and now and on into eternity. If you don't already have that certainty, then speak to me or to a Christian friend and ask how you can be that certain. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, you know how weak we are in the face of the pressures of this world. You know that we need something firm to rest our faith on if it's not to give way when the challenges come. Thank you for giving us your Holy Spirit to teach us and to guide us. Forgive us when we don't listen to his promptings. We thank you for inspiring the writing of the Bible so that we can know the truth about life, death, and eternal life, about sin and righteousness, about who we are both before and after we receive Jesus into our lives, and enough about what the future holds for us. Father, you have given us all we need in order to go forward with you with confidence and joy. Thank you, dear God, for such great love for us. Amen. Amen. I stand in Christ with sins forgiven, and Christ in me, the hope of heaven. Our closing song says, there is a hope that burns within my heart. This is a great song. Stand. To be home, to see your face at last, and to be set free from all the sin and suffering, the sorrow and pain that tragically floods this world due to our sin. Thank you for all the joy that will be ours when we make it home to be with you forever. Thank you too for being with us every day. Lord, we commit all your children living on earth into your hands that you might bless us all. So, Lord, send us out with your peace, that we might be a blessing to those we meet. Amen. Amen. Amen.